All right. So a very good morning to all of you here in the room today. Commerce changes the fate and genius of nations. The progress of freedom depends more upon the maintenance of peace, the spread of commerce, and the diffusion of education than upon the labors of cabinet and foreign offices. Respected fathers, Vice Principal Sir K.J. Devasya, our distinguished guest speaker Mr. Mathur, students of commerce stream, parents, teachers, and guests. It's an honor for me today to warmly welcome you all to this session on Career Enrichment Program for the commerce students of today. Amidst us, we have an eminent personality who has created a niche for himself in the field of taxation, audit, and consultancy, both in the government and private sector. Mr. Rajneesh Bihari Mathur graduated from St. Xavier's School, Delhi in the year 1983 and completed his Bachelor of Commerce from Shriram College of Commerce, Delhi University, and now is a fellow member of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. He possesses rich experience in the field of auditing and assurance services, corporate law, as well as income tax, and has successfully served clients across all his trading action industries during the course of his practice. His areas of expertise encompass statutory and internal audit, risk advisory, corporate governance, investigations and special audits, tax audits, entry-level strategy and corporate financial advisory. Over his professional practice of more than 30 years with B.B. Mathur & Company, he has successfully advised clients from all business and economic sections, domestic and foreign, with complex financial accounting and taxation issues, corporate treasury and company secretary functions. He also assisted the National Institute of Financial Management as consultant in the preparation of Estimate of Black Money, which was a project of the Ministry of Finance for bringing out the white paper on black money in the year 2012. On this note, I wholeheartedly welcome you again once, sir. Over to you now.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much, Father, for allowing me this opportunity. A very good late morning to all the students and teachers, parents, who've taken time out to join this conversation. I'm really grateful to you all. I wish and pray that you all are safe and healthy and are have successfully beaten the demon of COVID. Friends, I joined school in the year 1970 and distinctly remember going over to the school with my parents and meeting Father Saldana, who was known as Father Shikari at that time. I later came to know why he was called Father Shikari. He would string together several rubber bands and create a sort of a weapon with himself where he could just mildly hit a person who was making mischief, and so the name Father Shikari. I do not distinctly remember the conversation that took place at that time, but I remember that he gave me a candy. And fortunately for me, I remembered to throw the wrapper in the dustbin kept in the room. And I was admitted. Just that simple. The years from KG to class 6 were largely uneventful. I was just an average student and a follower in most of the sports that took place in the school. And I distinctly remember joining swimming sessions each summer, which happened after school. And by the time I learned to swim, the session was over. So I could never learn to swim till class 6. It was only in class 6 that I actually learned swimming. I was very keen on swimming. And our coach that time, Mr. Sebastian, suggested that I should take a breaststroke. That changed everything. Suddenly in class 7, I realized that I was number 2 in breaststroke in the school. And class 8 was again a game changer. Class 8, I beat the guy who was number 1. And I was number 1 in breaststroke. From class 8 to class 12, as luck would have it, I was adjudged the best swimmer in school. The years from class 8 to class 12 were mostly spent in sports. In winters, cricket, in summers, swimming. But the good part was that whenever we missed our classes, the teachers would always help us catch up with our studies. Even the school was very cooperative, and the exams that we would miss in attending so many inter-school competitions, we were allowed to take those exams separately. Something which I do not think happens now. And none of the other schools permit that. But we were fortunate that we were given that privilege. Class 10 was a landmark year in my life. This was the year I represented Delhi schools in the national swimming competition and won a silver medal. This was also one of the most difficult years in the academic part. By the time I finished with the competition in November, people had already finished their courses for the board exam, and there was so much talk of so-and-so completed the math course 2 times, so-and-so completed the science course 2 times, so-and-so was taking so many classes, and it was quite disturbing. That was the time I again depended on my teachers and took their advice and caught up with the studies part. That was also the time that I started taking studies a bit more seriously. Fortunately, the marks were fairly good, and I decided to take on the commerce stream because, and I think wisely so, because science was never my cup of tea. My family was also quite happy with that because my father was a practicing chartered accountant and everyone expected me to follow suit. Although at that time, I was clueless about what it took to becoming a chartered accountant. I had only seen people appear for the exams every 6 months only to fail and to appear again in the next attempt. However, I took commerce and started my 11th and 12th. There was a very important incident that happened in class 11th, which has stuck with me till date. Till class 10, I was competing in the under 16 category in the swimming competition. However, in class 11th, I was suddenly above 16 years of age and I had to compete in the under 19 category, where there was no chance to win because there were very seasoned swimmers in that category. So me and a few of other swimmers decided to approach the school principal and said that we would like to participate in the under 16 category only, which also meant that the school would have to falsely declare our ages. I never knew that this would result in one of the most serious rebukes and scolding I would ever receive in my life. I distinctly remember Father Parakat, who was the principal at that time, very categorically stated all of us that he would ensure that the entire sports career and entire sports thing would be stopped for all of us and we would not be allowed to participate in any event if we were to cheat. He said he was not concerned, he was not bothered if we won or not, but we would never be allowed to cheat. I was quite dejected at that time because everyone else was cheating and participating in the lower age category and we were being denied the privilege. But I think that was the right thing. And that has stuck with me in my professional career as well. Here in this profession, credibility is the sole aptitude that you need. And if you have that, you have everything. If you don't have that, you are nowhere. 11th and 12th passed on well. I was fortunate to get good marks in class 12 and got admitted to Sriram College of Commerce. Sriram College of Commerce was not what I had expected. It was supposedly the best college, but studies-wise, there was no comparison to what I had experienced in school. And Sriram College of Commerce also was important in one way that in that year, 46 of us, 46, it has never happened that one institution had 46 students going to Sriram College of Commerce. It was a record of sorts for St. Xavier's and SRCC as well. I do not know about the present scenario, how many people go to Sriram College of Commerce, but in that year, 46 of us went to Sriram College out of a batch of maybe 65 or 70, which was very surprising. Even the school was surprised. But then I think the credit goes to all my teachers. I remember in the first year of college, towards the end, I met a gentleman who asked me what I was doing. I mean, just as they ask you when they meet you for the first time. And I proudly said that I was studying in the SRCC. He said, okay, that's okay. But what are you actually doing? Which offended me to a certain extent because I said, I was studying in Sriram College of Commerce. Why is he asking me, what are you doing? Then he said that 3 years of college would leave you fit for nothing beyond that. So you have to start something along with college. At that time, I thought I should now take up the entrance exam, the CA entrance exam. The second year of college, I cleared the entrance exam and joined the profession. Since I had my own office, I had the privilege of being able to attend office and college together. Although in those years, the students were allowed to attend college and office if the office timings permitted that. Unfortunately, that is not possible now. I joined my office and took interest there. Fortunately, even though I was more of a sports person in school, office attracted me somehow, and I started working regularly along with my college. College was very okay. The teachers never really took classes there, and they just informed us that they were available in so-and-so classroom and we could reach out to them whenever needed. But then by and large, college was studies on your own. And there was no personal interest that any teacher would take in us or in our studies. However, once I started CA, I realized that CA is an exam where the papers are not difficult. What was difficult was the surprise element. The paper always had some questions which you never thought would be there. I mean, when you looked at the suggested answers, they would all appear to be so simple, each and every subject. But when you went to take the exam, you would be stumped because you never expected that sort of a question to be there in the exam. And I think this surprise element and the fact that most students are not able to complete their question paper are two of the major factors why so many people are unable to clear the exam. Fortunately for me, I cleared the dreaded CA exams in the year 1988 and I've been in practice since then. However, I am grateful to the gentleman who commented, though rather sarcastically, in my first year of college and asked me what I was doing, because had he not asked, I would have continued with college and probably ended up doing nothing, because in those years, university had a very bad name. There were so many occasions when the classes were disrupted either because of a strike by the students or because of a strike by the teachers. And so nothing much really happened. And plus the curriculum at that time did not keep pace with the changing dynamics of the requirements of various professions that one would engage in after finishing the college. However, fortunately for me, I started the CA and was able to complete CA in fairly okay time. And when I look back now, in the years gone by, I realized that probably the longest vacation and the best time I had was years in school. The 13 years that I spent right from KG to class 12. This is the time when each and every teacher gave us so much attention, encouraged us to do everything that we wanted to. And I think they were somehow superhumans. They had eyes on their backs also. And they had this amazing power to read our minds. Even when we were shy and we were hesitant to ask questions, they would somehow read our minds and would solve our problems. I do not know how they did it and how teachers get that special gift, but my teachers were always like that. And I remember each and every teacher, each and every class teacher from class KG to class 12. It has been almost 37 years since I passed out of school, but these teachers hold a special place for me even today. College teachers were different and indifferent. They would only answer questions that were asked in the class, never beyond that. And then that was just about it. We had some very big names in our faculty in SRCC, the people who had written so many big books. But then one never got to meet them. They would be just busy with their lectures elsewhere, writing books. So the interaction was not much with the teachers at college. The only good thing that came out of college was the friend that I made, which is one of the very important reasons why one must never miss out on college. I will come back to that later in this course of discussion when we take up the methods of entering the CA curriculum. But in my opinion, the college part is a very important part in one's overall education. So college just added a good name to my profile. It is always good to say that you attended the best commerce college. And I think that is just about it, because it's only good to start a good conversation and nothing beyond that. Coming to the various streams that one can join by taking up the commerce stream in class 11 and 12. There are streams like, of course, chartered accountancy is the foremost, company secretary, cost accountancy. You could do just normal BCom honors, BA honors, economics, bachelors of business administration, bachelors of accounting and finance, bachelors of financial markets, bachelors of banking and insurance. There are a number of streams like this, but without any disrespect to any other stream, I would think why should you be going to any of the second, third, fourth rated streams when you have the option of going in for a chartered accountancy course? This is a course which is the highest in the field of finance. And it, wherever you look in the field of finance, the top guys will always be chartered accountants. Now let us just question why and how this degree is important. I'll give you an example. Supposing you are in this place called Cyber City in Gurgaon. I'm sure every one of you have visited that place, and there are a number of tall buildings there. Let us assume that each of those tall buildings is a stream in the finance realm. Each of the buildings is 30 floors, and on top of each building, on the 30th floor, is a pot of gold. How do you reach there? With a CA degree, you get an all-building express elevator pass to the 10th floor. Meaning that whereas the others would have to do the stairs manually, you would be taken to the 10th floor directly, and from there you start your journey. With a CA degree, you get an all-building pass. You can enter any of those buildings and take the express elevator to the 10th floor. With the company secretary degree, probably two buildings will allow you that express elevator. An ICWA may be one, an MBA finance may be five, bachelor's of business administration may be one, bachelor's of financial markets just one. So why not take the course which will allow you straight away 10 floors in all the buildings? However, in this example, another important point is that beyond the 10th floor to the 30th floor, you will actually have to do it yourself manually. There are no express elevators there. So where a degree will take you initially ahead, will make you get a good job, will make you start a good career. Ultimately, it is your hard work which will push you through and lead you to success. There is no other alternative. And in fact, in the CA profession, that hard work is more, because you have to constantly keep on updating yourself. The day you decide not to update yourself, probably your professional career will get over. Because the laws, as a chartered accountant, we are supposed to know just everything. That is the general perception. And here, everything changes so frequently. The laws in our country are changing so fast. The business scenario, the business dynamics are changing so fast that if you do not update yourself, you are as good as finished. You will never be able to make a headway unless you are there, updated. And that is why the CA profession is so valued. Because CAs, A, because of the professional curriculum that they attend and the practical training that they do, and their aptitude to update themselves to the existing laws is what keeps them ahead. So, what all can you do with a CA degree? Present day times, how do you get to the degree? Do you need to do college? Do you need to do just directly from school? I think present day times, it is not possible to pursue a CA course along with regular college. And you can just either leave college, join School of Open Learning, join Indira Gandhi Open University and start CA. Or else you finish your college first and then come to the profession. In my opinion, college part is very important, because I think it is an important component in the overall growth and education of any student. The friendships, the networking that you get in college will be there throughout your lifetime. In fact, the school is the best that way. I feel the school networking, the school friendships will always last a lifetime. Second to that is the college, and then the others. In my case, school friendships, school networking has been the best. College, yes, but not as much as school. I am today connected to about 150 of my schoolmates. And whenever I tell that to anyone, they're quite surprised that how can you be connected to 100 people, more than 100 people, 37 years of school leaving. But then that's the fact. It is all because of our alumni association, DOCSA, which is such a powerful body, which has so many important people who are always eager to associate themselves with fellow Doxians, always eager to help fellow Doxians, then it has paid very rich dividends. In fact, I would recommend each of you to join this organization, be a part of it, actively involve yourself in this, because this will pay very rich dividends to you in future life. ultimately, when you start working, whether you're in a job or you're in your private practice, it is your associations, your networking, which will get you through, which will get you business. Your academics, your knowledge is one part, but to go ahead, you will need those connections, which will push you through, which will recommend you, which will take you through. So keep these links alive. Do not think that if you are intelligent only, you will make way. You will need all these people who are there with you, who will join different streams, who will become different people, go to higher positions, who knows who will become whom, and you will need all those people in later life. Coming to the profession's misconceptions, a lot of people in present-day times, when you talk of CA, the first impression that people get is CAs make a lot of money, handling money, changing the color of money. Those are some of the misconceptions that I constantly hear from students, from other people who are not familiar with the profession. So this is just a misconception I would like to clarify. Of course, with every profession, every field, there are some black sheep who will try all sorts of wrong methods to gain undue advantages, make undue profits, but then those are only exceptions. Largely, people in practice are those who will go by the law. Of course, they are experts. They will plan taxes accordingly, according to the relevant laws. They will plan taxes so that people make the best out of it. But they will never allow and they will never advise people to evade taxes. And that is where the fine difference comes, whether you are evading taxes or you're planning taxes. Planning taxes is legal and above board. Evading taxes is a crime. And if you had to evade taxes only and you had to become an outlaw, there was no need to become a chartered accountant. I mean, you would have been much better off if you started a career in organized crime or cheating right after 12th. You would have made much more headway rather than wasting your time with the CA curriculum and CA course. So in my opinion, anybody who wishes to follow those outlawed practices, those wrong practices, is not in the right profession. This is a profession of credibility. People trust you with their secrets. People trust you with their in-house things, inside information, and you are not supposed to utilize them for your own benefits. As I said, credibility is the most important virtue here. If you are not credible, you are nowhere, and people will not trust you. You will not get any business. You will not get any jobs. Everywhere you see, chartered accountants are in possession of responsibility. And if they start misusing this, they will not make any headway. So anybody who feels that pursuing this course to make undue advantages, to make undue money, I think you are not in the right profession. You are not following the right stream. This is a stream where knowledge is supreme. And you make money out of the knowledge that you have, not out of the undue advantages of knowledge that you are going to do. In present day times, our institute has a system where they will caution list a chartered accountant who has been found guilty of following any ill practices, malpractices, and this list is in the public domain. Plus, there is a new authority called National Financial Reporting Authority, which has the power to prosecute chartered accountants. So anybody thinking of misusing this profession is in for big trouble. I have talked at length about myself and the profession and would be doing great injustice to this session if I do not take you through the steps to becoming a chartered accountant. My people have put up a small PPT, which I would like to share with you, which takes you through the various steps that are there in becoming a chartered accountant, right from taking the foundation exam till the final. I will just share the screen with you and bring up the presentation.
इस पे करो।
ठीक है, या थैंक यू. सो जस्ट टू ब्रिंग इन अ पर्सपेक्टिव, आई एम जस्ट आस्किंग अ वेरी सिंपल क्वेश्चन. हाउ मेनी जीरोज आर देयर इन अ बिलियन? When I put this question, I also had to make a count, and I realized that there are 9 zeros in a billion. How much would be $2.6 billion equal to? Just imagine $2.6 billion at the present conversion rate of 76. It works out to something like 19,760 crores. That is the sort of net worth a chartered accountant called Rakesh Jhunjhunwala has. He is the man who is known as the guru of the stock market and also known as the Warren Buffett of India. He's one of the richest persons. And according to Forbes, his net worth was about $2.6 billion. Then there is Naina Lal Kidwai, another famous chartered accountant, who is the first woman to graduate from the prestigious Harvard Business School, who headed the bank HSBC. This could be you, because the possibilities are immense, and each one of you has that in you to be them. Taking you through the course, the course is governed by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. It is a very unique body, and this course is very unique because here there is nothing like, where are you doing chartered accountancy from? As you ask, where are you doing engineering from, or where are you doing MBA from, or where are you doing law from? Here, everyone does CA through this institute called Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. Why chartered? The profession, the CA Act, is approved by the parliament. This Institute of Chartered Accountants was set up as an accounting body in the year 1949 by an act of the parliament. So the name Chartered Accountant. ICAI, as it is called, is the second largest professional accounting body, only second to the American Institute of Certified Public Accountants. Institute has its head office at ITO, Indraprastha Marg, and the Board of Studies is at Noida, which is where every one of us interacts. All students, all chartered accountants have to be in touch with the Board of Studies to be transacting any business with the Institute. So what are the entry routes to joining this profession? There is a foundation route and there is a direct entry route. Foundation route is for those who wish to start after class 12 before completing their graduation. And there is a direct entry route for those who complete their graduation and complete their graduation with 55% marks. And also for students pursuing courses like company secretary and cost and works accountant, if they have cleared their intermediate exam, they can get a direct entry to the course. Those coming to the institute will follow this ladder that comes on your screen. So for those qualifying the entrance exam, they will have to register with the Board of Studies first. Board of Studies makes all registrations online, and then you will have to clear the entrance exam. Once you clear the entrance exam, you register with the institute and then take the training before you can appear for the articleship. This training is called Information Technology and Training and Orientation Program. This is an introduction for the CA students to technology, the use of technology, and an orientation to groom them. Grooming and the personal skills, soft skills, to be able to interact better with other people. Once you are through with the training, you can register as articles with one of the chartered accountancy firms. Let's take you there. I will just take you through the papers that are there in the foundation course. First paper is Principles and Practices of Accounting, which is 100 marks. The second paper is Business Laws and Correspondence and Reporting. 60 marks for business laws, 40 marks for correspondence and reporting. Third paper is Business Mathematics and Logical Reasoning and Statistics. Business mathematics. Mathematics is a part of it. And I do not think that you can do without maths in this course. Mathematics is 60% and 40% is statistics. The fourth paper is business economics and business and commercial knowledge of law. These four papers, once you clear them, then you are eligible to take the training and then come to the articleship part. The information and soft skill trainings is primarily, as I said, to familiarize you with the technology and the technology platforms which can be used in the profession. The orientation program is to familiarize with you with soft skills, accountancy profession, practical training. Once you are through with this, there are these two groups of intermediate. I will take you to the next slide, which is the registration as an article. This is a very important portion of your curriculum. This is where you register yourself for practical training with a firm of chartered accountants. Now, there is a very big debate whether you should be registering with a small firm or registering with one of the big fours. Big fours have their own advantages. Small firms have their own advantages. I will take you through the big four first. The big four, as they are known, are the top four global accounting firms, who are Ernst & Young, PricewaterhouseCoopers, KPMG, and Deloitte. These are firms which have global presence and have a very strict curriculum for articles. Their articles need to devote a lot of time and sometimes maybe 12, 14 hours of work to be able to get through. First, the entrance is difficult and then working there is also not easy. However, they provide the best of training. The systems that they follow are amongst the best. And what you learn there, probably you will never be able to learn in any other firm. The downside to it is that you get stuck with one or two subjects only. If you are assigned to audit of a particular client, all 3 years, you would be doing audit of that particular client only, which could be a limiting factor in case you wish to take up independent practice once you clear the exam. Because in independent practice, probably you will need to handle a lot more situations than a particular entity only. And you will need to know about taxation, you will need to know about company law, you will need to know about how to do tax filing. But here, with Big Four, that advantage is lost. In a smaller firm, that advantage is there. The disadvantage is that the smaller firms may not have as good systems as the Big Four have, but they offer you a better variety of the work that you will do, better variety of experience that you will get. Those wishing to go in for jobs should go to Big Four, because that is where you get a very good platform, you get a very good networking platform, and in case you're good, probably your senior will take you wherever he goes. Whenever he moves, he will take you as a team. In a smaller firm, you will get all the experience that you need to independently set up practice. And that is why anyone who has to make a choice between a Big Four and a small firm will have to first decide what he wishes to do beyond CA completion. If one wishes to do independent practice, I would recommend go to a medium scale firm and not to any of the Big Fours. If you wish to go in for a job, aim for the Big Four, for there is no comparison about what they offer. When to commence is a very important thing. As of now, as I said, the institute does not permit CA students to take regular college. So in case you wish to finish your college first, in case you wish to enjoy your college first, make friends in college first, do your CA only after college. Don't think in terms of starting after 12. Although there is always this talk that you should start early. Otherwise you're losing 3 years, you're losing 2 years. I don't think that's relevant in the long term. That's only relevant in the short term. And one should go through all the phases that are there to experience those phases and get something out of those phases. In the ultimate analysis, it will not make a difference if you do CA 1 year late or maybe 1.5 years late or 2 years late. Because what you would have gained in college probably will be lost forever if you miss out on college. Coming to the part of, once you register as articles, then is the challenge to take both the intermediate groups. You can register your articles only when you have cleared either of the groups of the intermediate, and then you can start the articles. In my time, one could just directly join a CA firm and be in the profession. over the years that has changed, and now you can only join the articles once you clear these groups, either both or one of the groups, which is in a way better, I think, because you are now more focused, you are now more determined, and you are more decided that you have to pursue this profession. In my days, people would just be sent to one of the chartered accountant's office, somebody who was known to the family, somebody who was acquainted to the family, and the head of the family would just say, no, please take my boy in your office and make him do CA. But then CA is not done that way. And half the time, people were not even interested in going to office, and they would just enroll and appear for the exams half-heartedly, which was the major cause why the percentages in those years were just about 2%, 3%. I think the difficulty was the same as it is today, but the people who appeared for the exams were underprepared or not prepared at all when taking the exams, which distorted the percentage which was reflected. Do not go by the percentages which are reflected even today, that there are only 20% or maybe 19 or 15% passing the exam, or just about 5% clearing both the exams, both the groups. Because I, in my opinion, it is just because of the fact that people are underprepared and are not giving their full to the exam. If you are diligent, if you are consistent, which I hold as the two most important virtues in a chartered accountant, if you are diligent and consistent, there is no way that you will not clear the exam. Coming to the exams, the papers that they're there in group one and group two, they're coming up on your screen. Group one has accounting, corporate and other laws, which is comprised of company law and other laws, cost and management accounting, taxation, income tax and indirect tax. Group two has advanced accounting, auditing and assurance, enterprise information systems and strategic management, and financial management and economics of finance. The finals, which can be taken only in the last 6 months of the practical training, has again four papers in the first group: financial reporting, strategic financial management, advanced auditing and professional ethics, corporate and economic laws. Group two has strategic cost and management, performance evaluation. Then there is an elective paper where you can choose between risk management, financial services, capital markets, international taxation, economics laws. These are all elective papers, and you can choose one of them. Seventh paper is direct and indirect, direct taxes and international tax laws, and eighth is indirect taxes, which has GST and customs. Papers are not easy, but as I said, unless you are diligent and you are consistent, there is no way you can clear the exam. But if you are, there is no way that you can not clear this exam. Coming to the career avenues, that once you are a chartered accountant, what are the career avenues open to you? So you could be in the field of auditing, either in service or in your private practice. Auditing entails statutory audits, internal audits, tax audits, certification work. Every company in India is required to get their accounts audited by a qualified chartered accountant. So this legislation ensures that chartered accountants will never be out of work. Ultimately, any company will have to get its accounts audited, and it will have to find a chartered accountant to audit it. Similar is the case with tax audits. The government has defined a certain turnover, a threshold turnover, beyond which they have to get themselves audited by a chartered accountant and submit a tax audit report. If you wish to follow the field of taxation, you could again be in a job as a taxation advisor in a company, or you could be in independent practice, as I do in my practice. Taxation is one of the major areas that I do. Taxation, again, could be direct and indirect and international taxation. All three offer a lot of scope. And this is where the question of black and white money comes, which I talked earlier. Project finance is another very important and interesting field where CAs are involved. They are the ones who decide, who design projects, who make projections, which are relied upon by the various financial institutions who fund them. So they play an important role in getting money to the people. And that is why they become so important, because ultimately every company needs money to run their show. Investment banking is another interesting area where people are involved in portfolio management services, investing in stock markets, managing portfolios for rich investors, international factoring services, making people get international finance, making people leverage finance between various countries, making use of the interest rates in various countries, and getting finance for people from outside. Banking and financial services is another big field where chartered accountants are hired. Banking industry hires a lot of chartered accountants to determine the correctness of the proposals that are sent to them for financing various projects. Chartered accountants are used to do the valuation part of the securities that are offered to the banks. Academics has turned out to be the biggest money grosser in the fields that the chartered accountants can venture to. I think biggest industry as of date is academics. All of you are a part of that, and all of you are the ones who make it a big industry. I see so many people taking classes globally now, online classes, thousands and lakhs of students joining, each one paying 10,000 rupees, 7,000 rupees. Imagine the sort of money these people make. Immense is the word. So this is a very big line, which has over the years beaten probably most of the lines. So this could be another avenue. Other fields are like KPO services. India is a major KPO supplier to various foreign countries where the cost of hiring professionals is much higher. India, because of the currency difference, Indian chartered accountants, Indian professionals come at a lower cost and offer much better services to all those people outside who hire them to outsource various processes to India. Another important field is the allied Indian revenue and allied services. You could, after completing your CA, go to IAS and CAG, which also has certain specific posts only meant for chartered accountants. And then there are a number of other things which a chartered accountant does, which I have not listed here, but then I see so many chartered accountants involved in so many things which one never thought initially that the CAs would be doing. Anywhere where money and finance is involved, CAs are there. There is no way you can do money and finance without a chartered accountant. Sky is your limit. So you just need to do CA, be consistent, be diligent, be prepared to do hard work, be prepared to be up to date with the knowledge, and there is no way anything can stop you. We can take the questions, and I pray and I wish that one day your signature will make an ordinary piece of paper a financial statement. Thank you so much. Ma'am, if you have any questions.
Yeah. Thank you, Rajneesh, sir, for such an enriching session on the career in chartered accountancy stream. I would just like to personally share something. I belong to a family of chartered accountants. Mm-hmm. My husband is a practicing chartered accountant. My father-in-law has been a practicing chartered accountant for past 50 years almost. So I have very, very high reputation for this career. And I strongly profess, you know, children to take up this career. So before we go further, sir, little questions that I have in mind and I wanted to share with you, with your students here is, we see a lot of children, taking up the course and then falling out of it in a year or 2 years. So what is your piece of advice here for the children who are wanting to get into the stream? On a personal level, what are the qualities or the aptitude or the attitude aspects that we need to see, children need to see so that they can evaluate themselves whether they are really meant to take up this journey ahead or not?
As I said, the two things that are most important here is your consistency and your diligence. This is not an exam where you can think of clearing the exam doing 60% of the course. That is how this is the difference between a school, a college and a CA exam. In school, you can see past 5 years papers, decide what will not come in the next year and eliminate so many things. College, again, you can do that. But CA, you cannot eliminate anything. You have to complete the entire course. And you have to give up the attitude of doing just 60%, 70%, 30%. Unless and until you are thorough with the 100%, there is no way you can clear it. And you have to practice. Timing of your questions is also very important. I see a lot of children not able to finish the exam, not able to finish the question paper. Imagine if the 100 mark question paper, you attempted only 80. Now you're going to be judged out of that 80. How can you ever think in terms of getting 50 out of that if you're not able to complete that paper? then you have to be exceptionally brilliant to be able to do, to get 50 that is required out of the 80 that you attempted. So unless and until you have that input, you have that ability to complete that course, that is something which is very important. So as I said, consistency and diligence. You can't be brilliant in flashes. You have to be consistently at it. There is no other way out. So those who fall out are probably the ones who are not able to give much time to their studies or are having doubts about the course. And then they see other people doing well in other streams. Unfortunately, today's world, we have these BPOs where people join immediately after school, immediately after college, and they're offered fairly good salaries, which lead people to believe that they can also do this. Why should they be studying? Why should they be putting in so many hours? But please understand that if a person in a BPO starts with something, say, like 30 or 35,000, the growth from 35,000 to 3,50,000 or to 35 lakhs will never happen. From 35, you will just go to 50 or 55 and stop there. So do you wish to be in that range or do you wish to go to 350 and 35 lakhs? Is the choice that you have to make. This is what I tell. Do not be swayed by what you get initially. You have to put in that effort. You have to put in that hard work. You have to be consistent. You have to be diligent. And as I said, if you are doing that, there is no way you will not become a chartered accountant. Imagine in our times, there were no coaching classes. So the only thing that we had to fall back upon was our previous year's papers, the suggested answers. There was no coaching. And mind you, all the people with me in college cleared their exam in 4 or 5 years. 3 years is the earliest that you can do. Everyone did it in four and a half years. There was no one who failed beyond that. They all completed CA and there was no coaching then. So as you said, why they fall out is not because the course is difficult. It is because they are not putting in their best. So that is important. I think they will need to realign their strategies to work hard and to study and to complete the course. And I'm sure they will be able to clear it. So somebody has to guide them on that please do not take it like an exam that you did in school or in college. This exam is a different exam. The dynamics are absolutely different. I think in school also you can teach them that.
Right, so we keep talking about this off and on. A very disciplined learning is required at a school level also. And especially for the subject like accounts, they need to get their concepts clear as early as in class 11th, and there's no looking back after that. So if the theoretical concepts are clear in class 11, that makes a huge impact in their later stages also.
Absolutely.
So now questions coming for the students are, so somebody wants to know, are there any advantages of taking both the groups together? Or should they do it one by one?
Absolutely. Both the groups has a very distinct advantage because here, in CA, if you have to clear, there are two requirements. A, you need to pass in each subject, which is 40% of marks. B, you need to get a 50% in aggregate also. Now, if you take both the groups together, no doubt you will need to put in more effort. You will need to study harder. But then you have a better chance of one subject done well, carrying through and taking you through both the groups. Supposing you do well in accounts, you do something like 80, 85 marks in accounts, that those 85 marks will take you through because then you will have an aggregate of 50% in both the groups. You may not score 50% in all the subjects, but then that 85% in accounts will carry you through. You could be having just 48, 49 and other subjects, but that 85% will ensure that you have above 50% average. So there is distinctly an advantage of doing both the groups together. And another advantage is that once you've cleared both the groups, you can have undisturbed articleship. So the next exam will come only 2.5 years from there, in the last 6 months of your articleship. So 2.5 years of articleship comes without any exam. And you can devote the entire time to your work and learning the practical aspect of it. So definitely, both the groups, I am all for it.
Thank you, sir. another question that we have is, this child wants to know, I'm planning of pursuing MBA from FMS Delhi after completing CA right after my class 12. That way, somewhere my college would be covered too. So would that be worth the time being invested? He wants to MBA and CA. In fact, CA right after class 12 and then probably MBA also he has his miss.
I do not see the distinct advantage that you would get by pursuing both the degrees in finance. See, ultimately in the field of finance, it'll always be the CA will be at the top. So why take a second degree, which is number two in finance, when you can take the number one degree? In my opinion, I would not recommend doing an MBA finance. If you have to do an MBA, do it in another field. So then you have a bigger perspective, bigger horizon. But finance, MBA and CA does not sound too appealing.
So would
and
MBA,
of course, as I said, sorry.
Yeah, I said, would MBA and HR would be a good option alongside?
Yes, yes, yes.
Because
yes.
If you have to do your own practice, I think MBA and HR would be
absolutely, absolutely, absolutely.
Later
HR, in HR is a very big line, and that's a very good and a very potent combination of a CA and HR MBA. Definitely, it would be worth it.
Right. Next question is, how much time is to be given between each paper if you clear? I think he needs to know how much time is to be given between each group if we have to clear them one by one.
So there is no, you can, if you cleared in this, in the supposing the May attempt, you can take it in the November attempt. No
that's
issues.
A minimum. Yeah, that's the shortest time.
The shortest, because the exams happen every 6 months, May and November. So if you clear in May, you're ready, you're good to go, unless you clear both the groups, supposing in the first attempt, your next attempt for the final will come only 2.5 years down the line. You can't appear in the finals unless you're in the last 6 months of your practical training.
Right.
That's the only limiting factor. But if you're taking one by one, there is no stopping you. I mean, there is no time. Minimum time is just 6 months, which is the time between two attempts.
Correct. Got that. Can I throw the next question? this child wants to know, don't you think there's already an abundance of CAs in India, which may adversely affect the future CAs if they are...
Okay, that's an interesting question.
Yeah.
If you still look at the number of CAs as we do in statistics, the per capita or how many CAs are there per 1,000 or per lakh of population, the number is very low in India. CAs are concentrated in metros only. But if you venture out, if you are looking at pan-India presence, the number is still very competitive. There is a lot of work. And even in metros, as I said, with so many avenues opening for CAs, this is the only profession which opens up many, many avenues, unlike a law degree or a medicine degree or any other architecture degree, which has very limited options beyond that. This degree opens up the entire field of finance. So why should you be limiting yourself to 1, 2, 3, or 4 items or only 1, 2, 3, or 4 streams? You have so many streams to go to. So I don't agree that there is abundance of chartered accountants. There is still a lot so.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Next question is, somebody wants to know if you can share that PPT.
Absolutely. I will share it with Devasya sir, and it can be forwarded.
Perfect, sir. Thank you. Next question. Is there any disadvantage of taking CA course after college? Alongside college or after college? I think you've already
Alongside college is not possible now. You will have to drop out of regular college. You will have to take up something like School of Open Learning, because the institute does not permit that. But then you will be missing out on college life, which I feel is a very important part of education. And you should not miss out. You can always, there are other people who feel that college is not relevant. And my opinion is that one should do college. One should not miss out on that.
Personally, that's what we also believe in. I mean, they should have a holistic education.
Absolutely.
Which college 3 years is very important.
Yes.
So somebody from class 11th wants to know, sir, should we prepare to be ahead of peers? I mean, that's what they want to know. Should they start before... time? I mean, in class 11th only, can they start their preparation?
I would not recommend that. If you see, what will happen is that your class 12th will get affected. I think class, you should take one thing at a time. Class 12th is important because unfortunately college admission depends on class 12th.
Correct.
And the absurd cutoffs that we see these days, which are nothing short of ridiculous. I mean, how do you say that only people above 98% will get admitted to a good college and those below 98 will not get admitted? So I think concentrate on 12th first. Take one thing at a time. Let it not happen that in the desire to climb the second stair, you trip on the first.
Correct. Mostly the commerce students feel that because sciences students are preparing alongside, so they feel that they should not lag behind in preparation for their entrance exams. So, but for commerce, I think there's a different game altogether.
Yes. Science 12th may not really matter if you're going to appear for an IIT exam or a medicine entrance exam. But if you have to do college, you will need to do 12th well. So you can't compare yourself with the science students in that way.
Thank you, sir. Can we move ahead, sir, with the questions?
Yeah.
So there's somebody who's asking, sir's personal recommendation, should we complete graduation? I think it's the same type of question, bring reframe, and then opt for CA or do foundation course along with graduation?
Doing foundation along with graduation does not make sense, because if you have 50% marks in graduation, 55% marks in graduation, you can directly enter the stream. You don't need a
as
foundation course.
Yeah, as it is. So it won't make any sense.
It won't make any sense. Why trouble yourself with more studies?
So next question is, ma'am, I want to know the progression like CA, which manages both in India and US at the same time. This is a nice question, sir.
Please come again.
Somebody wants to know the profession like CA, which manages both in India and US.
So unfortunately, India and US follow a different pattern. So they do not recognize our professional qualification and we do not recognize their professional qualification. In US, they are called certified public accountants, and they have also another, they have their own body like we have the Institute of Chartered Accountants. And if a chartered accountant wishes to practice there, they will need to do the CPA qualification there again. Of course, we get a few exemptions in the exams, but per se, you will need to take up that qualification all over again. As an Indian chartered accountant, you cannot work or practice in US.
So you have to pick up CPA over there.
CPA, yes.
Can we do CA with some other course? Just to whiten up our... like is not written, but I think probably she means law. There is a combination of CA and law, lawyers as well. Or CA with CS. But then CA itself, I think, is just like a big wholesome course. What do you have to say about that, sir?
No, I would say that do CA first, and then if you wish to enhance your skills or widen your horizons, go in for law, depending on the type of work that you're doing. For people who are in tax practice, law makes a lot of sense because it gives a broader perspective to the taxation issues. If you wish to do corporate restructuring, corporate consulting, a company secretary would help you. If you wish to be in the field of making projections, then another qualification probably will help you, where you learn to make those better projections. But then, as I said, that all depends on your line of work. So primarily a CA, then of course, depending on your line of work and depending upon your appetite to take up that course, why not? It would definitely help.
It's always better to pick up another next qualification after a few years of working and seeing where your interest lies and in which direction you want to take your career ahead.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Can a person become a CA without any tuitions or coaching? What's your take, sir?
Yes, absolutely, yes. In my times, everyone did that. So you just have to believe in yourself and not see what others are doing, because in present day times, the hype about tuitions, about classes is so much. I fail to understand that. I am sure you can do without it.
And there's a huge round of compliments coming, sir. I must appreciate the way you were conducting the session. So a lot of children are thanking you.
My pleasure, ma'am.
Okay, next question.
I would just say that in case anybody has any doubts, anything that they wish to know, I will share my email with the sir, and you can just forward it to them, and please feel free.
We'll be honored, sir. Does CA depends on the degree by which we are graduating? Like, will it depend if we graduate with economics honors instead of BCom honors?
No, not at all. Once a chartered accountant, everything fades. Everything done prior to that fades. Unless you want to go in for a job where your degree in economics will make a difference. So, if you have to go for practice, say, in fact, I would say it will not make much of a difference. I mean, it could only make a difference if there are five people and the job wanted, the job requirement has economics as its criteria, and out of the five, you are one who has economics, the others don't have economics, probably you will be favored. But more or less, it will not make a difference. Once you're a chartered accountant, only that counts.
Next question, sir. Ma'am, can we get a professional degree along with CA? Because these days, MNCs require multi-talented people. Professional degree along with CA. CA itself is again a wholesome professional.
You can always, there is no limit to what you can do as far as qualifications are concerned. However, the institute prohibits a chartered accountant from practicing any other profession. So you can, there are people who've taken CA, ICWA, CS, CMA, law, whatnot. But you will use only probably one or two of them, not more. You can widen your horizon, you can widen your knowledge. There is no limit to that. But then I think that should be decided by what you wish to do as a career and which stream you are following, what scope of work you have. Overqualification also could be a disqualification in some of the cases.
There's a time that you should be spending actually doing practical things out there. If you keep spending your time in studying and not utilizing yourself completely in the practical world, making more money, that also may be a disadvantage. One more question, sir, to maybe then we can wind up. People are asking to a comparison between MBA and CA after class. MBA after graduation and CA after class 12. So if they have to choose.
Courses are equally good. It all depends on what you wish to do as your, or take up as your career. Whereas an MBA finance is a broader qualification in terms of the scope that the subject offers. A CA is a more focused on accounting, taxation, and financial matters. So I would say as qualification, both are good, equally good, depends on which stream of work you wish to follow. If you are going to be doing auditing, doing taxation, go for CA. But if you are thinking in terms of doing something like financial management, if you are thinking in terms of working in something like a bank, maybe an MBA finance would also be equally good. So I think the answer lies in what line of work you wish to do. If you want to go in for your independent practice, definitely a CA. So I will not say that one is better against the other. It all depends on the stream of work that you wish to choose. If you are going to choose a stream where focused accounting, taxation, and finance are the core things, go for CA. If there is a broader management role that you are looking at, go for MBA finance.
So I think that answers most of the questions that were put up by students, and hope that they've got their clarity and this makes them more focused towards their career goals ahead. Thank you so much, sir, for being so patient. And I think education empowers, knowledge empowers, and most of us have, all of us in the room have got empowered today with your knowledge and your wisdom and your experiences and your nuances in life. I now hand over.
Thank you so much for hearing me out, ma'am.
Our pleasure, sir. And we'll definitely share your email IDs and your PPTs with students if they want to revert back to you.
I will just share the PPT with Devasya sir. The email is not here. I will send a PPT to sir, and you can share it with the children. And I will share the email ID as well. Yeah. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Over to Sivi sir.
Hello, ma'am. Can you hear me, ma'am?
Yeah, we can hear you, sir.
Okay. Good morning to all. Honorable Chief Guest, respected Principal, Vice Principal, teachers, and my dear. I, C.B. Joseph, the Commerce Faculty of the St. Xavier School, consider this occasion as an honor and a privilege to extend the vote of thanks. First and foremost, I thank God Almighty for the blessing He has bestowed upon us and for giving us the strength and the wisdom to achieve this dream during this alarming and frightening pandemic time. Once a great man whispered, feeling thankfulness and not expressing it, it is like a wrapping a present and not giving it. Right now, I use this opportunity to put all my gratitude in the world. On behalf of the school management and all the students, I would like to express my gratitude to our eminent speaker, Mr. Rajesh Vihari Mathur, for taking his precious time out and consenting to be the chief guest. Sir, indeed, your words have inspired the students. I particularly liked Mr. Mathur's speech, the way in which he explained his life experiences and the subject matter was extraordinary. Sir, it was heart-touching. At the same time, I bow my head before your gratitude, your ethical values, and professional experience. Thank you.
The pleasure is all mine. Thank you so much.
We have been fortunate to be assisted by our dear principal, Father T.J. Jose. You have been a constant support, and you have given us a lot of encouragement. Thank you, Father, for blessing us with your presence and guidance. I would like to thank the Vice Principal, David Sir. You gave me an opportunity to speak on this auspicious occasion. And it is a matter of honor for him. He is the man who worked secretly behind the curtain to ensure that everything is systematic and in order. I thank you from the bottom of my heart for your presence, guidance, and constant support. Let us have a huge round of applause for the teachers who worked behind the scenes. I use this opportunity to thank teachers, especially Shobha ma'am, Shipra ma'am, Maya ma'am, and Khan sir, all the Commerce Department teachers and all St. Xavier staff members. Last but not the least, I thank you for all the students for showing your interest and enthusiasm in this to make this program successful. I am sure that this webinar is going to help you and guide you in some way in your life journey. I thank all the parents who always support us, always in carrying out such an important event. I once again thank everyone for making this program successful. Thank you. Over to Shipra ma'am.
Thank you, Sibi sir.
Welcome, ma'am.
Rajneesh sir, we'll definitely look forward to more such occasions. And in fact, these kind of webinars would be, if at all we're conducting these kind of webinars, we would like to invite you once again on sure. More topics. Yeah. Yeah.
Sure. It'll be my pleasure, ma'am. Thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you so much, sir, for being with us today. Devasya, sir, can we?
Yeah, you can kindly wind up now.
Right. Sir.
Thank you. It was a wonderful program, especially the way you conducted it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.